because the damages caused by.
Jadi satu isu yang.
We were locked down for 84 days. Never thought of using it.
SPP ni ialah protection.
I think very immediate and very obvious.
We are basically now number one in Malaysia.
这是一种趋势现象.
Akan terjadi dengan pandemik yang COVID-19 ni akan.
Welcome to Post-Pandemic Recovery Dialogue. Everyone is affected by the pandemic COVID-19, unless you are in the glove manufacturing sector. How much did the pandemic affect our beauty industry in Malaysia? We are very glad to have two distinguished speakers today with us. Datin Winnie Lu, the founder of Acard Above, who has 41 years in this industry, and Shirley Lee, the managing director of Sotheby's. And I believe that they will give us very insightful opinion in this episode. Can you tell us what has you been suffering all this during the MCO? And after our MCO, it seems that there are long queues at the barbershop. So does it mean that your industry or your business has recovered from the pandemic?
Absolutely no. I'm very strict forward in saying that there was a surge and a rush for perhaps 2-3 weeks in June, because we started June 10. Some of my fast chain outlet, like I have a group just on solid cutting, we call it X-Cut, concentrates only on haircut. The queue was really tremendous because that salon, we don't take appointment. Whereas in my, let's say a Cut Above group, it's more premium brand, we were cutting off appointments because we really do not want too many clients jamming in at the same time. So when you talk about a surge of business, yes, in a way, but social distancing has made us lose many chairs. My salon may be, let's say, having 40 chairs, but for that season, until today, that social distancing has caused us 20 chairs less.
Yeah, half.
So how can you be busy when your appointment, let's say as a premium brand, we used to be full, but now till today, we are still not possible to take that off. And I really wish the government will come and check how spacious our salons are to talk about wasted a chair in between a chair.
What is the distance between
you see, our salon chairs are definitely around 1 meter or more away, or some even further. But if imagine if you took one chair off and have another chair, so the next client who sits is there. So if they don't do that to restaurants, why must they do it to a beauty salon? I mean, a hairdresser like us. I don't know, I really have so much thoughts. When they think that salons are quick in recovery, I really wish the government would do something about it, and even to the extent of taking that stigma of a 1 hour time service. That thing saying, okay, as long as you practice your SOP, you don't have to worry about the 1 hour timing.
Okay.
That will sound a lot better.
Yeah.
Take that off so the client will realize that, oh yeah, now can do, even the staff will feel that we can sell a service and say you can have a highlight or do something without fearing.
What about you? How does the pandemic affect your business?
Okay, I think one of the biggest impact on our business will obviously be the fact that due to the lockdown for almost close to 3 months, right?
Yes.
So the biggest impact is really the loss of revenue. And we haven't reached, you know, the peak of this pandemic yet, because when the moratorium and everything is lifted, right, from 1st October onwards, you know, so towards the end of the quarter, we probably will see recession and also a more significant impact. But as what Datin Winnie has voiced, I absolutely agree with her that the 1 hour, you know, restriction needs to be removed. Now, having said that, you know, our business is such that we are in a professional premium skincare category. So whether it was the pandemic or prior to the pandemic or even post-pandemic, all our appointments are actually, our services are only by appointments only. The clients are all dedicated private suites, you know, and private rooms. So obviously there is already physical distancing right from the beginning. But having said that, because of the 1 hour restriction, group quite a significant group of our customers still do fear, you know, and the stigma is that they do not want to come back to the salon because they are afraid that, you know, it's just a stigma created because of the 1 hour, even though there was already physical distancing, because everybody, you know, is accorded an individual room, you see. So I absolutely agree that that has to be removed. And I think if that has to be removed, if that is removed by the government, then I would believe that that would encourage many more of our clients to come back, you see.
So after this MCO, and now we are entering into it, RMCO, and it will be extended, and it has been extended to end of the year. So certainly there will be some changes in the way you do your business or even to your business model. So Datin, can you share with us?
Well, definitely it has to have a new normal way of doing things, you know, right now. Like for us, perhaps even after, after when the pandemic is over, you see, all along in my salon, we have been wearing gloves to wash clients' hair even long before MCO, because we've been through so many recessions. We've seen the AIDS days, we've seen all these and things. So we started wearing gloves for many of our the requests that the staff has hands had to be protected. So we will still continue to do so because it's good to be protected at all times. But there again, there has been so much fear about people going to the salon, but that thought should be taken off, because why must hairstylists be so fearful? Why are we why are we such fearing people that clients coming to the salon keep saying salons are a very risky place? They can go to clubs, they can go to bars, they drink without a mask on. So actually salons are a very safe place. Like we've been trying to tell the client, we practice SOPs, we have this, we have that. We will continue to do so unless after year end, maybe we'll see how the conditions works worldwide. We have not opened borders. But of course, if the government says now the borders are all open, I will still want my staff to wear masks for a time being until it's so certain that everyone is safe, because we work as a team. I do not want, we have about 250 staff, let's say. I don't want, because of one outlet, clients will go around and say, or social media can be very unkind, don't go to Calabar because
They
are affected. So we are trying to stop those kind of things. So whatever it is, we will insist that staff will wear masks until so much safer vaccine available and virus gone.
The same go to use?
But if we are looking at the changes in terms of the business, then I would look at it from a different perspective, because as far as execution is concerned, that part is rather easily handled. But looking forward, you know, it is a question of what do we do, you know, especially during this pandemic, right? And we are still going through it. How do we recreate ourselves in order for us to move forward and new strategies? So that is critically what we were looking at. So obviously for us is during the lockdown, you know, we are not open for business. We can't be open for business, right? So what we did was that, you know, one of the go-to would be to ensure that, you know, we really dynamically promote our online, our e-com sales, you know, our e-com revenue. That was what we did. And I must say that, you know, we were very fortunate that we saw a surge of almost close to 30% in terms of revenue on our e-com.
That's fantastic.
And that is purely because of its retail. So being a premium professional skincare brand, that means our business is both retail and service. So we don't only offer services in the salon, but we also prescribe products for home care. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it was very fortunate. Like I said, you know, we are still able to see a surge on our e-com sales. But then again, having said that, that is not enough because what happens, you know, if this pandemic, you know, is it lurks, you know, for another, you know, till middle of next year, till the end of next year, you know, then what's going to happen? We still need to continue to grow.
Yes.
All right. So obviously, currently, we are looking at different online strategies. So it's a combination of both an online and also an offline strategy.
In other words, the guidelines provided by the ministry is too limited. They just see this barber and salon as one business, one type of business. Probably the you know those who sit in the committee, they don't understand there are different type of services provided in this industry. There are actually subsectors as I look at it. So they need to detail out actually the subsector within your industry. I think that is the possible. Do you agree that you know perhaps that should be done? And if you think that should be done, if you have an association or probably you need to team up with others to put up a memorandum to the federal government to relax or to actually devise another different set of guidelines for your industry that suit your business.
Oh yes, I'm definitely looking into that because I'm also the advisor to the Malaysian Hairdressing Association and also involved with the Asia side, you know, because I really think it's important for this to be taken out so pampering can start back. Because clients, you see, those days we have a lot of clients who literally come in to pamper to just do wash and blow. But we hardly see such clients anymore. Because the client feels that without pampering, why do they want to go and have a proper wash? If everything is supposed to be quick, so why bother to pay exclusive money to go for a hair wash and blow dry? Yes. So you see, we have male clients that comes in, a real proper wash, sit down. It's like scalp regenerations. You need to regenerate back the scalp and improve the blood circulations. There's so many scalp treatments that you need to be on the chair, massage the neck, massage the shoulder. So you see, all these things is suddenly is like not happening.
In many countries, there was a surge in the sales of cosmetic and hair care products during the lockdown in the respective countries. Is that a trend in Malaysia?
Well, I would say that probably we are looking at online personal care. Yes, there was a surge and like I said, you know, we experienced a 30% growth on our online sales. But moving forward, I would look at it as in, is it sustainable, all right? Yes and no, because for those who still fear, you know, going back to the outlets and to the salons, they probably will still buy online. But services is not something that you can receive as what, you know, Datin has mentioned, right, online. You need to come back to the salon. So I foresee that that is only confined to retail and also home care products. But with more than 17, you know, thousand of registered and licensed beauty salons and also, you know, then what are these people going to do, you know, if this restriction, yeah, if everybody goes online, right, and we have, you know, more than 75,000 and we're only talking about registered outlets, right, and we employ more than 75,000, you know, people, employees, you know, within this this sector itself. So it's very important for us to look into the livelihood, you know, of all these people. And coming back to the pampering, and I think the pampering is really, really important. For us, we use the word cocooning, you know, because you are in the outlet itself. It's like you are like a cocoon. You're being really, really pampered. Now, why is that important? You know, during this pandemic, everybody is stressed out, okay? So it is very important, you know, for us to look into the well-being, all right? So actually receiving treatments like this, you know, when she's talked about the scalp release therapy, even going for facials, etc., it's actually well-being. It's true. It's not just about looking good, you know, looking nice, looking neat, and looking presentable, but it's truly about the well-being.
Looks like it's time to educate the people to pamper themselves.
No, why not? I think that's the only way for the economy to come back, because you see, if these people don't come out to spend, how is the local economy going to improve? just like the government is pushing local holidays. We are all doing that. I think if everybody helps each other to spearhead back the economy, even without opening borders, people will not hoard their money. Because you see, we fear rainy days. We keep saying, oh, now cannot spend. If everybody have the same thoughts, nobody want to spend, then how is the economy going to boost again?
I was told that you have a lot of foreign clients. And now with the close of the borders.
So sad, right?
Yes. Yeah. So, you know, it's a big loss. So, is there a possible synergy between your business with CHR Share Business to actually collaboration so that, you know, you can replace that part of your
income.
One day
we can talk.
Yeah. Very good suggestion.
Yeah, because honestly speaking, because like my Pavilion Group, we do at least 30% of that, a lot of foreigners. We have a lot of people from Middle East and even from China, So yeah, we also have a lot of hotel recommendation. Mm. They live around the vicinity of the hotel and then they say, hey, where's a good hairdresser to go to? Sometimes they do refer our brand to them. Mm-hmm. So we totally losing out all these things, you know. And then a lot of our clients who are actually Malaysians, but they live around. They live in Singapore, they live in Hong Kong, they live around the nearby. Mm-hmm. They always come back to do their hair because somehow, the families are here, but they can't come back because no point to be quarantined for 2 weeks just because you want to come back to do something, you know. Mm-hmm. So we're also losing out Malaysians who are living elsewhere for work.
Yeah, you have something to share with us on this point?
Well, we are not that affected with the borders closed because all this while, I would say that more than 90% of our clientele are locals, right? Because we believe in retention, right? Because there's only so much space within the outlet. Mm. So we believe a lot in retaining clients. And the only strategy moving forward for us would be how do we grow our market share through, you know, different strategies to target the local customers. Lah. So that's what we are looking at. Mm. And of course, one of the strategies that we're looking at would be creating business opportunities for probably, you know, individuals who may have lost their employment or anyone who wants to start a an entrepreneurial side business, but there's only so much space for that number of people. So this we call the independent agents, and we're only talking about reaching out to the local, you know, customers, and through, you know, the prescription and also the sale of our products, right? Not services, because that is a very skilled labor that is required. So that is the strategy that we will be adopting.
Since you have so many outlets, do you have a plan to, say, set up an academy for that?
Okay, we actually operate something like about, currently we have about 50 over outlets throughout Malaysia, licensed partners, of which 4 are corporate. It was a thought, we thought about that. It's something that we wanted to do, but there are certain other constraints that we had in mind, because one of the challenge that we had is that to really prepare, you know, or rather to really equip one to be a therapist, it takes a lot of work, especially to reach a certain level of excellence, right?
Master.
Yeah, correct. But unfortunately for us, we look at it as in the attrition rate of all these therapies are such that it is so quick and so high, right? Sometimes we wonder whether is it, you know, worth it for us to actually start an academy.
But it's something perhaps that online.
It wouldn't be possible to do it online because a lot of handwork involved, all right? And this skill, you know, can only be taught and imparted in a physical location. It's not something that you can teach online.
Now, there's a lot of changes and rapid changes in technology. Would that help your industry? For example, artificial intelligence and others?
Well, personally for me, technology has actually been pretty helpful. even during the MCO, at the height of the MCO, because I do a lot of training for India. Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. a 1 hour thing via social media. Mm-hmm. So it was great. Because of that, it was actually linked up to Greater India, you know, that kind of thing. Mm. Yeah, and I also used that as a way to reach out, you know, using social media to sort of create a lot of styles and awareness. And I am at the same time during the MCO doing a lot of webinars and classes on motivation, because I have been training a lot of all this brand yourself to success. So it's really part and parcel of the ongoing thing. So technology has really brought a lot of fantastic awareness into my trade, because I do more than just cutting hair now. Mm-hmm. I also do skill class.
Mm-hmm. Did you do the same?
Well, for us is that as far as technology is concerned, earlier I shared with you about the independent business partner strategy. So it is an online platform. So what we want to do is to recruit X number of SOTIS independent agents to be able to start this online business. So all it does is that you need to just be equipped, you know, and we have a 360 platform to equip them and to, for them to start doing this business. No capital involved,
alright,
no capital involved, and no inventory involved, alright. So what they need to do is just to be equipped, and the right candidates obviously would be able to build this business online, alright. And with this online platform, it would allow them to start a new business, and all the inventory, etc., you know, would be managed by us. Delivery, etc., would be managed by us, and all they need to do is just to ensure that, you know, the customers come on board. They do a good job, fantastic job of ensuring that they prescribe the right products to the consumers, you know, and they can build a thriving business, right? So that's what we are looking at. Yeah, so we are hoping to recruit a couple of hundreds agents, you know, throughout Malaysia, and we see that as an opportunity, you know, for those who require, you know, additional, you know, and supplementary income during this difficult time.
That is inspiring. A lot of people are very pessimistic about the future. Okay, what do you think the future of your trade?
Well, one thing I must say, I think I'm in a trade that no matter how down the market is, the hair grows. So there will still be business.
Yes.
So I believe sometimes in entrepreneurship, I've seen the 80s, I've seen the 90s, the early 2000s. So a lot of crises have actually been in my circle of 41 years, right? But of course, this really mother of all-time crisis. Because we're fighting a pandemic. So, but I believe as entrepreneurs, we must always have a very strong mindset that what goes down will come up, you know. So it's a matter of how you fight, like the fittest of the survival game, you know. So those who can't make it this time, this is it. So I believe in our group, no matter how, we will still fight this. And yeah, perhaps if 2021 is not good enough, I'm sure in 2022, we will come back stronger. It's not about the profits now, you know. We really talk about as strong as we have strength. Most important thing is how are we going to turn around this next couple of months to still ride through 2020 so that next year will be a better start again, you know. So
keep yourself afloat.
Yes, keep yourself afloat. It's really not about making money, but as long as this year, even if no bonus for the staff, mind you, we have not even retrenched anyone.
Oh, great.
Yeah, it's been so wonderful. We still hire two people. We wanted a digital marketer. We wanted this, we wanted. We managed to find you because of such time. Such people is not available before. So at least we are still able to be choosy about who we want to hire now. So we look at the possibilities. Not so bad after all. Because people you can't hire before, now you can hire. So
yeah, there's always
so
a
we want to have that. Yes, we want to have the fighting spirit that next year, if not the year after, will be better. So we just for now, tag along, stay afloat. Don't, well, we said don't curse. Don't curse the darkness too much. Introduce the light. That's, I think, as an entrepreneur, we must always stay very positive.
This pandemic, perhaps it is a blessing in disguise for us.
We change strategies. Yes, otherwise, we'll be so complacent, right?
Yes. I believe that happens to you also. That may be your problem.
I would say that what I shared about the new business model was something that we wanted to embark on before the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And the pandemic actually was very timely. You know, it actually has proven to us that, you know, the model is something that is a necessity. Mm-hmm. So we're going to move ahead with it. But irrespective of whether there is a pandemic, I always believe that entrepreneurs, you always need to put on a growth mindset, and you know, continuous learning is very important, and we always need to sit and reflect and say, hey, you know, where do we take our business, you know, from here? So we have survived 30 years, not 41, but 30 years, okay?
And, this is long enough.
It has not been easy, but I would say that after the, in fact, we wanted to introduce new aesthetic, you know, treatments within our outlets, and we're very happy to say that, you know, after the pandemic, the minute we opened, within just 2 months, right? Okay, at the close of August, we introduced a new, you know, the aesthetic treatments, and we actually have already gotten our ROI, you know, within just 2 months.
Oh, this is really
great. So I look at it as in, you know, we just need to continue to reinvent ourselves and introduce. Like I say, you know, new treatments, new strategies, etc. Because we are the leaders of the organization, and all our employees are looking at us. Okay, so we need to continue to steer the ship and to ensure that, you know, like what she said, we have to thrive. You know, and we have to actually maneuver ourselves and try through this difficult time. And I believe that the last 2 months has been pretty good for us. There's still a lot more that can be done. But over my years of experience, I realized that it's all about the mindset. You know, when we work with partners, we work with, you know, many individuals, it is always those people who have a very positive and a growth mindset that are the ones that have proven that they are able to cross over, and they are able to continue to survive, and not just survive, they have, you know, they have thrived.
That's a great mindset, so actually, that is needed, very much needed at this time.
Yeah.
Okay, beside the guidelines that you have criticized just now, you have other you know, proposals for the government, be it the federal or the state government or even the local authorities, to help the industry to pull over or to pull through this time.
Well, I think for hair, maybe the government possibly, is it because this year was supposed to be a Visit Malaysia year, right? So we can't, but we keep saying support local holiday. So maybe if the government can actually be part of this and say that pamper yourself, go and do this, go and do that, I think it can be, you know, it can be create kind of like a tagline that you need to be pampered to go through another challenge in your life, right?
Beauty so all tourism.
This, yeah, so all these little thing, whether
it's well-being,
hair,
tourism, yes, that's exactly. A good idea, yes.
So you can be actually from other states coming to the city or certain place, go to certain, of course, we keep talking about destination holiday, they need to like revive back hotels and all things, but why can't they revive back the beauty space?
So what do you think, Sherry? Pamper yourself in Sotis. In Selangor.
There was this point that you mentioned about a beauty academy.
Yes.
I think that's something that maybe my mind has been, you know, not totally open for a while. But I thought that was a good thought, you know, that's probably something that could be pursued. Because I generally think that, you know, the beauty industry in terms of the standards of excellence can still be improved. You know, there's still a lot, there's so much room, you know, for improvement. Maybe that's something that, you know, if possible, you know, we could, you know, work with the relevant, you know, bodies to discuss about this and to see how, you know, we could elevate the standards, and a really, really good academy or training school can be looked into. Yeah, that's one thing that I think on my side, you know, we could consider to pursue.
So thank you, Datin and Shirley. Thank you for the very inspiring and exciting dialogue. As the saying goes, there's a will, there's a way. And we have seen what Datin and Shirley have told us about their experience, very valuable experience, and I hope that it will help the whole industry. Now we have heard so much about the voices from the industry. And let us look at the policy of governments and see what the government has to offer.